Our next speaker will be Professor Wang Hui from Tsinghua University. Professor Wang Hui is currently here at Harvard as a coordinate research scholar, and together with Professor Peter Bowl is teaching a course on contemporary Chinese thought, I think, or intellectual debates in contemporary China. Professor Wang started his career as a scholar in Chinese literature, focusing especially on Lu Xun, but over time moved into the area of Chinese intellectual history. For some years, over a decade, he was co-editor of the influential journal Du Shu, and he has written a number of very important works, perhaps most influentially his four-volume work, The Rise of Modern Chinese Thought. Wang Hui is not a newcomer to the Harvard-Yenching Institute. He's been here previously as a research associate, and also in 2010 was a Pusey Fellow at the Harvard-Yenching Institute. And in that year, in 2010, he was also Harvard-Yenching's keynote speaker at the Association for Asian Studies. So it's a great pleasure to welcome back Professor Wang.
Yeah, thank you very much. When I got this title, Asian Studies in Asia, it reminded me of the early experience. The first time when I heard this topic, Asian Studies in Asia, was in the beginning of the 21st century, when the Ford Foundation founded a program as Asian Studies in Asia. I was invited to interview the applicants in Beijing, and which was quite interesting for me. Interesting because I suddenly realized that when I interview those applicants, many of them came from like Guangxi, Yunnan, Sichuan, as well as Beijing. Other, why those applications from Guangxi, Yunnan, Sichuan, or those either the Guangxi Academy of Social Sciences, Yunnan Academy of Social Sciences, as well as the Minzu College in those areas, Southwest Minzu College there. So because a lot of the scholarship on the area studies, especially Southeast Asia, were focused on that regions. It's very close to Vietnam, Burma, and Thailand, and other Southeast Asia, or some other places to the Tibet and India and Nepal. So these were from these different regions, which also first time, even for me, to remind us, so what is Asia for Chinese? What's the meaning for Chinese? Because before that, we thought that the Chinese is an Eastern Asian country, but actually that the Eastern Asian was, as a category, was very difficult to define China properly, because China could be thought as an Eastern Asian country, Southeast Asian country, Central Asian country in Xinjiang or other areas. So these are very diversified, the country, and also the different linkages. And these also reminded me of two intellectual projects. When the Professor Park already mentioned that inter-Asia culture studies, which was also emerged in the beginning of this century. And another, almost at the same time, initiated by the Professor Naoki Sakai and Brad DeBerry, who were based in Cornell, but trying to launch a project which entitled the Traces. We plan to publish that in the four or five languages. We did that in English, in Japanese, in Chinese, in Korean, that's originally, and then try to plus in Spanish, German, and so on and so forth. The basic idea was trying to challenge that English hegemony, because we're trying to search for the self-expression, for allow the people to write in their own language, and published through the translation, multilingual translation. That was a beautiful idea, but extremely difficult project. So only existed for a certain period. Now, I don't know whether or not it's die or not yet, but still, the idea was remained there. And another project, Inter-Asia Cultural Studies, is much more successful and still among the cultural studies. And but that project, it's published only in English. So though the contributors came from different countries in Asia, but published in English. So which also means that on the one hand, you have these kind of intellectual project try to challenge the traditional Asian studies, but actually you have to work with the English. So in that sense, the part that become part of the Asian studies in the English world, rather than in other world. It's, though they're inferential, they try to, but it's very difficult because once you publish it in English, not in Chinese or Korean, then it's very difficult to follow up the progress in that society. It is a really another issue because it's that the local people will not that enthusiastic for these kind of the journals, but still the people mainly, the contributors came from the colleges and universities who were mainly come from the, those in, with the links with the English world. So this is the three projects, Asian Studies in Asia, Inter-Asia Cultural Studies and the Traces were three projects, which also remind us that Professor Park also mentioned that the diversity of Asia itself and how to understand that. And that, I think, the in Chinese case context, is very difficult to use the Asian studies in American sense. I mean, in here, the area of studies, we have a lot of the now we also followed, in the 1990s, we followed the trend in American that the Asian Pacific studies in Chinese Academy of Social Sciences established, and they transformed that. But basically, we still not used so much about the Asian studies. We had the Chinese studies, Japanese studies, or Middle East studies, not the general idea of the Asian studies. But that idea also, once we more frequently use that the term of Asia, we actually help us to re-identify ourselves. What's the meaning of it? We are, as an Asian, how to define us in these global contexts. So these are the big issue, as I mentioned that at the beginning when I involving these Ford Foundation projects interview, suddenly I realized the diversity within China and the different connections with different regions in Asia. So here, but on the other hand, I want to highlight the three imbalance in the Chinese studies, in those Asian studies, it's not only about the Asian studies, but about the international studies as well as the domestic studies. The first imbalance is that the last 30 years, the most of the developed the scholarship was mainly about concerning the developed countries, especially America, Japan, and the European studies. So a lot of the institutions, a lot of the investments on that. And partly because, and also very strong team on these fields, partly because the overseas students who graduated here and there back to China. So that area of studies became stronger and stronger and stronger. However, it was very difficult for Chinese scholars to study in Southeast Asia, South Asia, the Central Asia, Middle East, Iran, and other areas, and not mention the African countries. So these area studies became weak and weak. So even compared to the 30 years or 40 years ago, we still can find the leading scholars in Chinese academia, like Ji Xianling and Jin Kemu, those Indian specialists occupying the high position in Chinese academia. But now it's very difficult to find the same figures in this field. Not mention not only the Indian studies, Indian studies, they have a long tradition, but no same scholars in African studies, Latin American studies, or other specialists in Asian studies. I mean, not Chinese studies, but the Asian studies. Most famous scholars came from the Chinese studies, and some were from African, American and European studies. Japan was very exceptional because after the Cultural Revolution, so many overseas students studied in Japan. So Japanese studies in China compared to other area studies of the cross-nation studies was much stronger than any other the fields, the same fields. So that was the imbalance between, which means that the imbalance also reflected the inequality of the whole global situation. So that the first imbalance, we need to improve that. Second imbalance is that about the Chinese studies in China. Because now, as Professor Perry mentioned, that we had a lot of the Guoxue Institute for Center and the Institute for National Learning and so on and so forth. Not only these, but also a lot of the in the Department of History, Department of Literature, and so on and so forth, a lot of the team and the scholarship and the students were focused on the classical Chinese and the modern Chinese, the literature, history, intellectual history, and so on and so forth. However, compared to, especially for those the leading universities like the Peking University, Tsinghua University, Fudan University, still very few scholars and the working on the minority studies. Of course, like Tibetology, Mongolian studies, or not mention some small the minority studies. Partly because after the 1950s, China established a system that the Minzu College system. In the central Minzu University, with the Minzu, it's very difficult translation because before that we used the nationalities. And now after the last decade, they follow the American way to use the ethnic studies. But now people feel it's very difficult to translate. They don't know how to translate the Minzu into nationality, nation, ethnicity, and so on and so forth. So they just translate that as a Minzu. So if you look at the Minzu University. So those universities is a system, and a lot of the students from Tibet, from Xinjiang, from Guangxi, Yunnan, they actually went to these universities for the training. So anthropology and Minzu studies and others were focused on these areas. So, but that gave the difficulties for the real interaction between the social science and humanities as well as the interaction with those Minzu studies. So now it's also the imbalance in I also talked to the professors from Peking University. We calculated how many the students in the fields like sociology, political science, came from these regions, try to focus on these regional studies within China. It's very few. It's very few. This is a second imbalance, I think, we need to improve. And I actually made the suggestion that we need to change the structure of that. Establish, move, not only focus on these Minzu studies, minority studies in Minzu college system, but move a lot into the normal universities, especially for those leading universities. The third imbalance, I think, happened last years because the last year, it's also followed the American model. It's largely established a lot of the think tanks in China. China had its own the think tank, like Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, or the province had their own the Academy of Social Sciences, but now they are moved to another the model, the American model for the think tanks. But these think tanks were mainly for the economic, political, strategic thinking, rather than the basic studies. So because without the basic studies, it's very difficult to develop the high qualified the think tank. It's if you, now the there was a now the Chinese government issued the it's initiated the project the One Belt One Road, and a huge money invested on this. So that's why the Ministry of Education also want to encourage that to develop the basic the research in the universities, and especially along the road, the One Belt One Road, to develop the new the linguistic studies, religious studies, cultural studies, historical studies about those different nations. So which also interesting that remind us that the One Belt One Road is another category. It's not the region. It's not a simple area, but it's a really cross-border, of course, but it's how to say, there's a very different taxonomy and very different ideas for the promote these regional studies. But this is eventually it's there promote these regional studies, area studies, but the reason and the category and the idea will be very different. But these give you the motivation for these developments of new area studies. So these also, I think it's interesting because the Asian studies in Asia, and I remember that in the 1990s, both I think in Japan, South Korea, Taiwan and mainland China, especially in South Korea and Japan, was very, a lot of the scholars, including the governments, are passionate to develop the regional integration projects. So that's why the Asian studies in Asia became a topic at that time. But you see that the global situation, regional situation now became more complicated and even dangerous. So in this context, it's not so much, I think, like, it's still there, the regional integration project that was still there. But as China initiated the One Belt, One Road, that was a different idea, which was very different from the regional integration project. It's another kind of the regional integration projects. It's like the people when the EU project in crisis, when Britain, the so-called the BRICS happened, some people will think about another way for connection, meaning that Britain, India, China, or others, not the same regions, only continental regional integration, but through another way to think about what is area, what is a region, what kind of the use the road, the belt, and so on, so other category to describe the new imaginary about the world. I think we need to think about this issue when we talk about the regional studies or Asian studies in Asia now, how the transform, the follow the change. The last one is that since we have no such clear taxonomy of Asian studies, area studies, in the sense of the American area studies, okay. We need to think about that the whole the regional studies in the whole situation of the humanities social sciences here. I just want to mention that in China, mainland China, Taiwan may be two places where the investment on the humanities social sciences and also the faculty, the scale of the faculty continue to expand, especially in mainland China. So that was 2 years ago, the Professor Sheldon Pollack from Columbia organized a conference in India, invited scholars from non-Western countries, trying to have an evaluation of the humanities in those areas. The result is that the only mainland China and Taiwan was continue to expand, especially in mainland China, partly because the Chinese the university system is continuing to expanding, and also the Chinese government has set up the foundation, the social science foundation, for encouraging the studies in the humanities. that was, I got the number at the beginning was in 1991, founded, only 5 million Chinese RMB. But to the 2010, not mentioned here, is 2.6 billion. And now I have no the number, but last 5 to 7 years, you can imagine the radical increase for that. It's not the, I think it's more than 3 billion, that's absolutely. And covered all the social sciences and humanities. And in each province, and direct the controlled municipality, like Beijing, Shanghai, all set up the independent office for managing these projects. Now, it's in 2013, they also initiated another project for the so-called Zouchuqu, go abroad, for the Chinese classics and the texts, the books. That it, by the 2013, it's about the 3,700 kinds of books were exported. Because China has a huge imported copyrights of other books translate, but more and more Chinese books were translated into other. And now it's the more than 400, right? The 440 Confucian Institute, the 646 Confucian classroom, and covered 120 countries. So that was the together with the establishment of Institute for the National Learning and so on and so forth. These were large scale expansion that explain that together with the area studies. But these are the early stages. I think that the Tsinghua University 4 years ago established a program that was the developing country studies as a PhD program, but mainly those students studied in Asian countries or Latin American and African countries. So another category was developing countries, not the Asian studies. But the basic requirements for the applicants that they need to speak English as well as at least one smaller language, for me, it's Javanese or other South African languages. But we have no teacher can do that. So that's why they set up the program, have the two tutors. One tutor was from Tsinghua University, another tutor from other countries, either from American institutions or European institutions. And then they sent the students study here for at least for 1 year. Then study, they can spend 2 years in object countries there and come back to the Tsinghua University another year for the dissertation writing and the defense. So that's the basic situation. Thank you.